that really made a difference. The fact that everybody was having the same problems and working on the same thing. And then these small companies, you know, like Intel and Qualcomm and Apple and these guys started creating these amazing commercial electronic systems, and we're taking advantage of them. And that really changed the performance capability of these systems. But the key thing is that small spacecraft is not a good definition. And that is one of the big problems we have. The AAA in the US, I'm in one of the committees, a small satellite committee, and we spent the first four meetings figuring out what should the small satellite committee work on, because nobody could agree on what small meant. There were some guys saying, oh, anything below 500 is ours. And I was like, 500 is not small. That's really, really big. So it's not a good definition. We've been toying with the idea of using lean space, following like lean business and lean engineering. There's other people trying different things, but small is not a good way. People get really, really caught into the size issue, and we need to forget that. The big difference between what we do and what traditional space does is philosophical, is not dimensional. And we have to figure that one out. Let's think about what industry has done. That's the other big change we're seeing. We went from universities and you know, amateur radio and things like that to commercial. And that has some very interesting implications. In 2000, we had a few universities working on pizza and a little bit of pocket change to buy the parts, flying these satellites. And it's exploded. We've had lots more universities, but the actual funding numbers are still very, very low. Universities don't bring a lot of money to the table. So that had an effect, but it wasn't a big thing. The next thing that happened is the government started getting interested from a scientific perspective. So we had NSF in the United States and QB50 from the European Union. And then some of the military in the US got interested as well. So now the amount of money available to do these very small missions went up significantly. And with it, the capability of the spacecraft and the amount of effort dedicated to full pointing, you know, reaction wheels, star trackers, all that kind of stuff started becoming, yeah, $100,000, I can spend that. Before it was like, oh my God, I can never. Well, and then the VCs jumped in. And those guys have very deep pockets, and they're willing to make an investment to get what they're after, and that's performance and capability and mission success. And that means that the funding levels that we're seeing on these very small spacecraft are growing exponentially. And the other thing that's very interesting is if you spend $1 billion on long-range space telescopes, you may get something, but not much. But if you spend $1 billion on CubeSat technology, you change the paradigms and you do things that couldn't be done before. So that injection of cash is having a very, very significant effect in the capability of these satellites compared to what the same amount of money would have if you're thinking about Mars missions, which are extremely expensive. The other thing that has happened is the companies that are involved with CubeSats and SmallSats have changed. When we started, all we had was basically, when we started, we had nothing. But very quickly, we had a few component suppliers that provided you with a part if you needed. Pumpkin being the first one. Here's a computer, you know, Clyde, ISIS, GOM. They all were giving you a part. Later, we had people bringing complete spacecraft to the table. So now you could go by a bus. And what that meant is a lot of people that were payload developers all of a sudden could build a spacecraft. I'm going to buy a bus from GOM or from Pumpkin or from ISIS, and I'm going to put my payload in there and launch it. And the next thing is we basically went to full missions where you actually don't sell a spacecraft, you sell the data. Whatever is Planet Labs pictures, Spire data, Satellogic imagery. All those things are things that you can do now that were not there before. So the industry has changed dramatically, both on scope and on funding. And right now, it's a big, big deal. A few years ago, it was this small little training exercise, if you want to call it that. So what are the regulatory challenges that come with this new way of doing business and with the things that are happening? Well, the first thing is we have new developers that don't have a lot of experience. In some cases, they have no experience, and that is actually a good thing. We've seen a lot of innovation come out of people that were not aware that what they were doing was impossible. And when they succeeded, it was like, okay, it was impossible, but you managed to make it possible. So it's a good thing that we have new players and people from other industries and other ways of thinking jumping in, but they're unaware of what the regulation requirements are. And sometimes they start very late. And then they get in trouble and they blame the regulation. You know, that stopped my launch, and it was horrible. We have small budgets. You cannot just say, well, there's this lawyer that has spent the last 20 years learning about, you know, the ITU things, and they're going to do my filing. My budget is, you know, $100,000. That's all I got. They have very fast development, which means you don't have a lot of time to get that process running. We have very large numbers, and we've seen these in many places, but the regulatory agencies sometimes are not set up for the numbers they're getting, because that's not the way space is supposed to work. It's supposed to be only a few a year, and now we're launching hundreds a year, and that's a different way of thinking about it. And then we have very new operational concepts. We're doing things that are not the way you're supposed to do space. Okay? You have very large constellations. When somebody goes and says, oh, I'm going to launch 600 satellites, it's like, whoa, wait a minute. You know, that's not normal. You have a problem. There is also this idea of augmenting and replenishing your constellation continuously. You know, every few months or every few weeks, I'm just going to put more satellites up. When I have a chance, I'll just put a few more up. That's not the way you think about launching satellites in the past. It's a very big deal. You know, you plan it for years and you go. And now it's like, hey, there's an empty spot. I'll just put my satellite in. And that doesn't work well with the regulation. The other thing is we have a lot of things with global coverage. People with multiple ground stations in multiple places, people picking up data everywhere, which means a lot of the single ground station, single downlink location, it's not working anymore. I want to be able to download anywhere. We're working on SatNet, where we want somebody in England to log into my ground station in California and contact their spacecraft. It's like, wait a minute, that's completely illegal. But we want to do it. So how do we figure it out? So what do we have to do? What are the responses we need to put on the table to make this work? And I think it's great that we're having this meeting. And Attila, just thank you so much for doing it, because we need to work together to make it work. And we all need to change. The first thing is the developer community needs to understand we need to get better at it, we need to get educated, we need to be good citizens. As experienced developers, we have to help the newcomers. So when you hear somebody tell you, hey, I'm starting to work on a CubeSat, ask them what they're doing for licenses that day. Don't wait until you talk to them the next day. And then the other thing that we need, that sometimes is a problem, is this idea of, when do I become a commercial satellite versus an amateur satellite and I can use the ham licenses or not? People, because they're afraid of the regulation, they really try to put themselves on the ham radio side, and sometimes it's really not right, but they still do it because it's easier. And I think it'd be great if we had a very clear explanation. No, you're commercial, don't worry, it'll be okay. That doesn't mean the regulators don't have to do anything. There should be an effort to simplify and streamline the process, because not just because that'd be great, but there's a lot of numbers coming in, and if we make it easy, then we can handle it. If we make it bureaucratic and difficult, it's going to choke the system. Is it possible? Are the laws written in such a way that we can simplify things? Sometimes we can, sometimes we can't. It's going to help the regulators, because the workload is going to get insane if you have those numbers. And I think this is critical. We need to figure out what's the minimum paperwork we need. Okay, and I'll give you an example in a second. One thing that we're seeing, and in the US this is happening, is the launch coordinators can really play a key role in informing their customers. This is the checklist. These are the things you have to do regulation-wise. Go work on that now. Because if you start in 6 months, you'll be too late. And that really helps. So we should get better at it. The one thing that's interesting is a lot of this is already happening in certain agencies. In the US, with the launches that Cal Poly is doing, we have FCC standard paperwork, so the everybody sends something that the FCC likes. We don't get things bounced back 3 or 4 times because you forgot to fill something. NOAA recently changed their initial contact process to a one-pager, and you give them a resolution in the camera, and if you're putting a cell phone camera in orbit, they still have to check it because the law says if you're imaging the Earth, you have to check with them. But they understand that it's not a national security issue. So you do the one-pager, they look at it, they say, yeah, you're not a threat, go have fun. Before, you started with a 25-page report, and when you're doing 30 of these a year, the regulators didn't want to see 25 pages that many times. The other thing that we've also seen is if you standardize the documents, it makes it a lot easier to read. So that's another thing that we're trying to do is have nice templates for people, put the important information in these places, and whoever's reviewing it can do it very quickly, and it really helps them. The other thing that was interesting, the amateur guys were really good. At the very beginning, they changed their process to a web-based... You went. That's okay. Everybody knows who it is. But they actually changed to a web-based application process because when we told them we have 15 satellites coming, he's like, wait a minute, I don't have... Those guys are all volunteers. He said, I don't want to deal with this much. So it's really happening, and it's possible. We just need to kind of work together to make that happen. So conclusions. We have a new ecosystem in space. It's a different way of doing business. It's not the same. It will never be the same. It's not going away, and it's only going to grow. And it's going to grow exponentially. That's just a fact. If you don't like it, I'm so sorry. Blame me. The other thing that's clear is that developers have to follow the law. We cannot not do that. But the regulators need to get ready for this new reality. It's not that you cannot continue to assume that everything is going to be like it was. So what that means is that collaboration is going to be the key to success. And so you have engineers and lawyers have to get together and talk to each other. And sometimes it's hard because there is this language barrier between legalese and engineerese, if you want to call it that. What we're seeing is, confrontational attitudes are not productive. We've been in a mode where the community was blaming the regulators and the regulators were complaining about the community and we didn't get anywhere. So that's not good. But we can really bring in new ideas and new processes and new concepts, both as regulators and as developers. I think the developers are trying to do the best they can, or we should help them to do that. So I think that that's the key. We have to work together and make things happen. And I think that's it. And thank you, everybody, for coming. Thank you, Attila, for making this happen. I think it's really important to sit the right people together in the same place. And we'll make this work because these little guys are not going away, and I think they're a positive thing for the world. We just need to make sure we do things right. And if you have questions, go for it.
Jordi, thank you for excellent, motivating speech. Really great. Quick, 2 questions. Peter, and one more or the no, yes. And I tell you before Peter is going to speak, Yvonne left, we are friends here, I tell you secrets. Boss is not here, I tell you secrets. Just the reaction to the presentation. Imagine we got, and it's not completely secret because it's on our webpage, but you don't see it. Peter knows, Serling knows about it. We got several filings in December where the filings contains 4,000 non-GSO FSS in coordination band, even not the easy one, non-coordination. That's why, please trust us if the Bureau will be able to process these for